about evidence-based treatments for couples having unexplained infertility. This is a guideline from the practice committee of the ASRM. So this has been published in February of this year only. So it's a fairly recent guideline. And let me take you through this particular publication. Now, it's important to understand how these guidelines have been formed. Look at the top left corner of the table. What they have included is randomized control trials or systematic reviews or meta-analysis of RCTs or systematic reviews of meta-analysis of a combination of RCTs, control trials without randomization, and large cohort studies or trials without randomization. What they have not included is descriptive studies or case series or case reports or non-systematic reviews. So what this is focusing on is primarily large controlled trials which have some strength. Before we go into the actual guidelines, these are the definitions which have been followed in this guideline. What has been defined as unexplained infertility is inability to conceive after one year with routine, that is all standard and basic investigations of infertility, showing no abnormality. So diagnosis can only be made after the basic evaluation fails to reveal any particular abnormality. This should include evidence of ovulation, adequate sperm count, and fallopian tube pregnancy. So these three are the major investigations which have been included. And this also mentions that nearly 30% of the couples fall into this unexplained infertility category. So essentially, it is a diagnosis of exclusion. And to confirm the diagnosis, the clinician should consider three aspects. One, was the infertility evaluation complete? Two, was the infertility evaluation performed correctly? And thirdly, was the infertility, the result of the evaluation interpreted appropriately? All these three are very pertinent. It should be complete, it should have been correctly performed, and it should have been interpreted appropriately. Keeping this in mind, the guideline focuses on these specific areas as treatment of unexplained infertility. It begins with IUI in a natural cycle, timed intercourse with clomiphene, timed intercourse with aromatase inhibitors, timed intercourse with gonadotropin, IUI with clomiphene, IUI with aromatase inhibitors, IUI with clomiphene or aromatase inhibitors with low dose gonadotropins, IUI with only gonadotropins in low dose, IUI with only gonadotropins in a conventional dose. It then spends some time on timing and the number of IUIs, and lastly on the role of IVF in couples having unexplained infertility. So in a sense, this follows the algorithm of simple ovulation induction, unstimulated IUI, minimal stimulated IUI, gonadotropin IUI, and then moves on to IVF. And as I mentioned earlier, the guidelines are based on what has been published, predominantly looking at RCTs. So let us start with the first. And this is IUI in a natural cycle. Now, IUI is often considered as the first line of treatment in couples with unexplained or mild factor infertility because it is simple, less invasive, and less expensive. When we look at IUI with natural cycle, there are 7 randomized trials, 1 cost-effective study, and 6 cohort studies. So there is plenty of evidence looking at the role of IUI in the natural cycle. And some studies amongst this have compared natural cycle IUI with ovarian stimulation alone without IUI to gonadotropins and IUI. And these are some of the studies. The first study is clomiphene citrate or an unstimulated IUI compared with expectant management. It means the patient has not been given anything. 580 couples or with having unexplained or mild male factor into 6 cycles of IUI alone or with an expectant management. And what this study showed that after 6 cycles, the success rate of an unstimulated IUI in terms of live birth rate, it is not higher than what one would expect with spectrum management. Second, again, looking at the cost effectiveness, it was concluded that treatment with IUI was also not supposed to be cost effective compared to spectrum management. And this is looking at non-stimulated IUI. So what this guideline mentioned, that there is strong evidence that IUI in unstimulated cycles is less effective than ovarian stimulation with IUI, and it is not significantly more effective than expectant management. It is essentially natural cycle IUI and expectant management are more or less the same. Hence, it is not recommended to perform IUI in natural cycles for couples having unexplained infertility because it is less effective than ovarian stimulation and IUI and likely to be not more effective than expectant management. And the quality of strength of evidence is very strong, and this recommendation is extremely strong. We then move on to simple timed intercourse with clomiphene, timed intercourse with aromatase inhibitors, timed intercourse with gonadotropin. When we look at clomiphene and timed intercourse, there are 4 RCTs and 3 systematic reviews for sufficient evidence. There is high quality RCTs also looking at right up to live birth. And what does this guideline mention? That there is good evidence that clomiphene citrate with timed intercourse is no more effective than expectant management. Second point, compared to unstimulated IUI, clomiphene and timed intercourse is also not more effective than expectant management. And hence, it is not recommended to use clomiphene citrate with timed intercourse as a treatment measure of unexplained infertility because it is no more effective than expectant management. Timed intercourse with aromatase inhibitors. Now, this also includes 2 randomized trials and 2 systematic reviews of RCTs. One of these is presented here. A high-quality RCT with nearly 1,000 patients and clinical pregnancy rates was no different between letrozole with timed intercourse versus medically unassisted, that is expectant management. Again, the summary statement for timed intercourse with aromatase inhibitors, there is good evidence that letrozole with timed intercourse is no more effective than clomiphene with timed intercourse or expectant management. And hence, it is not recommended to use letrozole with timed intercourse as a treatment for unexplained infertility. Then we move on to gonadotropins with timed intercourse. We all know that ovarian stimulation with gonadotropins is considered to be more aggressive than ovarian stimulation with letrozole and clomiphene. This potent action of gonadotropins compared to the oral drugs frequently results in the development of higher number of ovulatory follicles than what one would achieve with letrozole and clomiphene. And for this particular guideline, there are 4 randomized trials and 1 systematic review. So again, sufficient evidence. Now, there are conflicting reports regarding pregnancy rates when you would compare IUI with low-dose gonadotropin to low-dose gonadotropin with only timed intercourse. The 2 older RCTs in couples, in less than 50 couples, showed higher pregnancy rates in their IUI arms compared with timed intercourse. In one, it was statistically significant, but in the other, it was not statistically significant. And the Cochrane review, which showed that conventional dose with timed intercourse was not associated with higher pregnancy rates compared to the oral age. So there is conflicting evidence. What does this particular guideline mention? That there is insufficient evidence that gonadotropin with timed intercourse is superior to expectant management. And there is moderate evidence that treatment outcomes with gonadotropins are similar to oral medications with timed intercourse. But we need more studies, and most studies report no difference in pregnancy outcomes. So what is recommended is that it is not recommended to use gonadotropins with timed intercourse in the treatment of unexplained infertility because either there is no difference in pregnancy outcome or there is a higher pregnancy rate with a higher risk of multiple gestation. So the use of gonadotropins and timed intercourse does not seem to improve the overall pregnancy rates, but it significantly increased the risk of multiple gestation. Then we move on to the different categories of IUI, and herein we look at IUI with clomiphene, IUI with aromatase inhibitors, IUI with clomiphene or aromatase inhibitors with gonadotrophins, IUI with low-dose gonadotrophins, and IUI with high-dose gonadotrophins or conventional gonadotrophins. All five categories of IUI has been assessed in this particular guideline. Now, ovarian stimulation with IUI forms the mainstay of fertility treatment in couples having unexplained infertility, and it is commonly used as an antecedent to IVF. Significant evidence on this, because there are 19 randomized trials and 14 and 4 systematic reviews and 3 cohort studies. So plenty of evidence you looking at the use of clomiphene and IUI. Some of the studies which are presented here, which shows the first one, that in 200 couples with unexplained infertility with clomiphene and IUI over 3 treatment cycles, got significant increase in live birth rates versus expectant management. But there are some studies like this Cochrane analysis, which showed that clomiphene plus IUI compared with expectant management did not increase the live birth rate. But when comparing clomiphene versus letrozole, there are 4 randomized trials and 2 systematic reviews. And we have shown some of the studies here. But again, the evidence is conflicting. So what this guideline suggests is that there is strong evidence that clomiphene with IUI is superior to expectant management. It is superior to natural cycle IUI in terms of live birth rates in patients with unexplained infertility. This also mentions that multiple pregnancy rates in clomiphene IUI range from 0 to 12%. And this is likely to be due to different patient populations and different dosing and different cancellation. So this is a very strong recommendation that clomiphene citrate with IUI should be used to treat couples having unexplained infertility. What about IUI with aromatase inhibitors? Again, there are 8 randomized trials and 2 systematic reviews and meta-analysis. This is a very large retrospective cohort study, 14,500 IUI cycles amongst 8,600 infertility couples having unexplained infertility. Natural cycles, clomiphene cycles, letrozole stimulated cycles, and gonadotrophin stimulated cycles. So what this study shows that compared to a natural cycle IUI, the live birth rates were significantly higher with clomiphene, letrozole, and gonadotrophin. All these 3 led to higher live birth rates compared to natural cycle IUI. This also mentions that multiple pregnancy rates were significantly higher in the clomiphene and gonadotrophin groups, but not in the letrozole group. And this is something which is understandable because the percentage of couples having multifollicular development with letrozole is significantly less, because the mechanism of action of aromatase inhibitors is different than that of clomiphene. This, again, one systematic review comparing letrozole to clomiphene citrate in patients having unexplained infertility. In direct comparison between letrozole and clomiphene, there was no difference in either the pregnancy rate, miscarriage rate, multiple pregnancy rate, or in the number of dominant follicles. What the guideline comes out with is that there is strong evidence that there is no significant difference in pregnancy rates or multiple pregnancy rates following letrozole with IUI as compared to clomiphene with IUI, and both are superior to either expectant management or to natural cycle IUI. Hence, it is recommended that letrozole with IUI be considered as an alternative regimen for couples having unexplained infertility. The issue in US is that it is not FDA approved, but in India we do not have this problem now. Both clomiphene and letrozole are better than unstimulated IUI or simple stimulation without. We then move to the combination of clomiphene or aromatase inhibitors in a low or a conventional dose. Now, combination therapy of this oral drugs with gonadotropin has been explored to improve the pregnancy rates beyond the oral agents alone. And there are 6 RCTs and 6 cohort studies that assess the response in this particular category. One such RCT demonstrates that there is no difference in the live birth outcome in clomiphene with IUI, low-dose IUI, low-dose FSH IUI, or sequential clomiphene plus low-dose. So these 3 randomized trials suggest that there is no difference comparing clomiphene and low-dose with the combination of the. So what do these guidelines suggest? And it is important to understand this point. There is fair evidence that clomiphene and conventional low-dose gonadotropins are associated with higher pregnancy rates as compared to expectant management. There is good evidence that clomiphene with low-dose gonadotropins are associated with increased risk of multiple gestation. And there is good evidence that clinical pregnancy and live birth rates are similar when comparing letrozole and low-dose gonadotropin with IUI versus clomiphene citrate and low-dose gonadotropin with IUI. So what the recommendation is that it is not recommended to use letrozole or clomiphene citrate plus conventional dose gonadotropin in IUI because most studies have associated improved pregnancy rates, but this comes at a significant risk of multiple gestations. What about now IUI with oral with injectable gonadotropins in the low? What has been defined as low dose is less than 150 international units per day. Now, this has been suggested as an alternative to IUI as opposed to the conventional dose to reduce the risk of multiple gestations and ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Now, there are 13 randomized trials and 1 systematic review of this. Now, 2 included RCTs show that expectant management resulted in similar pregnancy rates and similar time to pregnancy compared to IUI with very low dose gonadotropin. But there are other studies which have shown that there is a higher chance of pregnancy. A cost analysis also shows that IUI with low dose gonadotropin had a significant higher cost per ongoing pregnancy. So what is the summary statement of this group in the use of low-dose gonadotropin and IUI, yet there is insufficient evidence that treatment with low-dose gonadotropin and IUI is associated with higher pregnancy rate compared to letrozole or clomiphene alone. In couples with unexplained infertility who have a good or intermediate prognosis, there is fair evidence that treatment with low-dose gonadotropin with IUI is no more effective than 6 months of expectant management. And there is no difference in the multiple pregnancy rates in this group. This group concluded that it is not recommended to use low-dose gonadotropins with IUI in the treatment of unexplained infertility as it is complex, expensive, and likely no more effective as compared to oral. This comes primarily from safety and cost. What about then the use of conventional doses? There are again 8 randomized trials and 2 cohort studies. By conventional dose, it is more than 150 international units per day. Now, since HMG and REC-FSH have similar effects, they are both treated as a general class of gonadotropin. Let us look at this first RCT, which compared low dose versus conventional dose gonadotropin and found a similar pregnancy rate, but the risk of moderate to OHSS requiring hospitalization was significantly lower in the low dose. This article in the New England Journal of Medicine, an RCT of 900 patients, this found that there was a significantly higher live birth rates in the gonadotropins and IUI group, but this came with a significantly higher risk of multiple gestation, multiple pregnancy rate of nearly 32%. This is significantly. Another RCT, this is the fast track trial in the USA. This trial compared the patients as follows. In the conventional protocol, patients had 3 cycles of clomiphene with IUI. If this fails, there were 3 cycles of gonadotropin with IUI, and this was followed by 6 cycles of IV. In the other arm, the accelerated protocol, the second aspect of 3 cycles of gonadotropin was dropped, and after 3 failed clomiphene IUI cycles, patients were immediately fast-tracked to the IVF. Now, this study reported that patients who went on the accelerated protocol had a shorter time to pregnancy than those treated with the conventional protocol. Hence, the authors concluded that in young women below the age of 40 years, treatment with an accelerated protocol, that is clomiphene 3 cycles moving on to IVF without any gonadotropin IUI treatments in between, this resulted in a shorter time to pregnancy with fewer treatment cycles and cost savings. So the summary statement for this by this group is that there is insufficient evidence that treatment with the conventional dose gonadotropin with IUI is associated with a higher pregnancy rate, and treatment with conventional dose shows no difference in the pregnancy outcome but has a risk of multiple gestation. The recommendation of this group is that it is not recommended to use conventional dose gonadotropins with IUI, as most studies associated with improved pregnancy rates are also associated with a higher multiple pregnancy rate. So either the rates are equal if the studies have strong cancellation criteria, or if the pregnancy rates are higher, it comes at the cost of a higher multiple pregnancy. This then brings to the last two aspects of this particular guideline, and that is about the timing of IUI. Now, the most effective method of timing insemination and the optimal number of inseminations that should be carried out per cycle has been extensively debated. Now, this guideline is based on 7 randomized trials that has assessed both the timing and the number of IUIs in patients having unexplained infertility. In terms of timing of IUI, this is a randomized study, very interesting study. This is a study of couples who were undergoing gonadotropin stimulation, in whom in 106 cycles, IUI was performed 34 to 36 hours after the HCG. And in another 98 couples, IUI was performed simultaneously with the administration of HCG. Very interesting. Half of the patients, the IUI and HCG administration was done at the same time, and in the other half, it was done at 34 to 30 hours later. And what this study showed, that there was no difference in the clinical pregnancy rates in both the groups based on the IUI. Again, looking at several RCTs which have compared a single IUI at 34 to 36 hours, comparing to double IUIs, at varying time intervals between the first and the second IUI. These studies demonstrated no difference in pregnancy rates between single and double IUI in couple having unexplained infertility. That is, the pregnancy rates are mentioned in yellow. And again, a randomized controlled trial, single RCT determining higher pregnancy rates following double IUI with versus single IUI. So there are some evidences that double IUI might be better, but most of the studies show that a single IUI does not have inferior results compared to double IUI. So what this group has recommended is that there is fair evidence that timing of IUI relative to HCG injection between 0 hours to 36 hours does not impact the pregnancy rate. And if you look at the physiology, the logic behind this is that sperms remain alive in the female reproductive tract for 48, 72 hours or even longer. So even if the IUI has been done significantly or a few hours before the exact time of ovulation, it should not impact the pregnancy rates because the sperms are going to remain alive. As opposed to this, the oocyte loses its fertilizing ability very fast. Hence, you do the IUI anytime between the administration of HCG and the time of ovulation, that is 36 hours, there should not be a significant difference in the pregnancy outcome. There is also fair evidence that live birth rate following single IUI is not different than double IUI. Again, coming from the same logic that once you have injected sperms, these sperms are going to remain alive, and giving another bolus of sperms 12 or 24 hours later should not improve the pregnancy outcome. So what is the recommendation? It is that a single IUI be performed any time between 0 to 38, 6 hours relative to the injection. Then we come to the last aspect, and that is the role of IVF. Now, due to steady improvements in IVF technology over the past two decades, it has become the most effective form of treatment for practically all causes of infertility. But it is substantially more invasive and more costlier than other methods. So this guideline tries to review the evidence which evaluates the efficacy of IVF and its suitability as a first-line option for couples having unexplained infertility. And this guideline includes 12 randomized trials and 8 cohort studies assessing IVF for unexplained infertility. The first one looks at 253 couples in whom having unexplained infertility who have been randomized between expectant management and immediate. So 253 couples compared expectant management for 6 months to immediate treatment, which included 6 months of ovarian stimulation with clomiphene or low-dose gonadotropin with IUI. And couples randomized to expectant management also underwent up to 6 cycles of OS with IUI followed by IVF if not pregnant. And after 3 years, there was no difference in the cumulative life. The second study looked at patients with long-standing unexplained infertility. And this concluded that in couples with long-standing infertility, unexplained infertility of more than 2 years, women who underwent IVF immediately found a higher clinical pregnancy rate compared to expectant management. There are also a number of RCTs which have compared a conventional approach of 3 cycles of OS with IVF alternative of IVF as the first line. 3 such studies included in this guideline assess women with a mean age of less than 35 years and showed no difference in the pregnancy rates compared to ovarian stimulation with low-dose gonadotropin and IUI versus. But the important study is the 4th study, which is for women aged 38 to 42 years. And this study showed that immediate treatment with IVF yielded superior live birth rates compared to the treatment where IUI with FSH or clomiphene was done first. So in patients who are elderly, who have poor ovarian reserve, reporting directly to IVF would give higher and earlier pregnancy rate as opposed to going in a stepwise fashion by doing IUIs first and then moving on to. So the summary statement is that current evidence does not support IVF as the first-line therapy over expectant management in good young patients. In the Western world, this is below 38. In Indian women, this could be younger. There is good evidence that immediate IVF in elderly women is associated with a higher pregnancy rate and a shorter time to pregnancy. There is also good evidence that in couples who fail to achieve a pregnancy following clomiphene and IUI, immediate IVF results in a shorter time to pregnancy rather than incorporating a gonadotropin IUI cycle. There is also good evidence that there is no reported difference in clinical pregnancy and live birth rates when comparing IVF with conventional fertilization with IVF to ICSI in the setting of unexplained infertility. However, ICSI has been associated with higher fertility rates and a reduced risk of complete fertilization failure as compared to conventional IVF. Hence, it is recommended that in couples with unexplained infertility, young patients, poor prognosis, ovarian stimulation and IUI should be the first line of treatment. And if this is not successful, IVF would be the next line. So this is what these guidelines conclude with. But one of the other aspects this has focused on is the risk consideration. The major risks associated with therapies or treatment in unexplained infertility are primarily related to the ovarian stimulation process, because all ovarian stimulation processes lead to multiple development of multiple polyps, leading to an inevitable risk of OHSS multiple pregnancies. The risk of both multiple pregnancy and ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome should be a considerable factor, a deciding factor before you consider the treatment. Age of the female partner, duration of infertility, and the overall desired family size are also other important consideration in the decision to delay or do the treatment. So this study concluded that with compelling evidence that a strategy of 3 cycles of clomiphene citrate IUI followed immediately by IVF in a shorter time to pregnancy at a lower cost than a strategy that includes an intervening gonadotropin IUI course. And while IVF is an effective treatment for unexplained infertility, it is also associated with a higher risk of multiple gestation, preterm delivery, and low birth rate, and it could be possible. So what is the recommendation for future direction? For most couples with unexplained, the first line is 3 cycles of IUI followed by IVF. But importantly, there is a pressing need for additional therapies to bridge the wide gap in the effectiveness between ovarian stimulation and IUI and IVF. I would end by adding 2 slides that we should remember that what does the patient come to us for? She's coming for a pregnancy, not treatment. She wants the pregnancy in the shortest possible time, the most cost-effective way, and in a safest possible way. We need to look at 2 things. One, what is the time it takes to achieve a pregnancy, and what is the cost required to achieve a pregnancy. We must also know that many patients feel that if a cause for their infertility is not found, we will not be able to treat them. And the common question every time we ask is, what is the reason for my infertility? We should try to explain to the patients that our technology for treating infertility is far superior to our technology for making a diagnosis. So the real challenge is educate the patient to change the question from why am I infertile to how, as it is, how should you be